in prison, locked up in chains. Sin held me captive to sorrow and pain. Tears of frustration as love passed me by, until the master heard my heart's cry.
Grace, marvelous grace, I needed grace to pardon and make me whole. Grace, marvelous grace, flows from above, infinite love, marvelous grace.
I was downhearted, broken inside, praying for mercy with nowhere to hide.
There was a Savior searching for me. Grace overflowing set my soul free. For grace, marvelous grace, I needed grace to pardon and make me whole. Grace, marvelous grace, flows from above, infinite love, marvelous grace. I am forgiven, I am redeemed, a brand new creation. He saved me and gave me a reason to sing. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Grace, marvelous grace, I needed grace to pardon and make me whole. Grace, marvelous grace, flows from above, infinite love, marvelous grace, marvelous grace, marvelous grace. Thank you.
praise number 281. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. We're going to sing first, third, and fourth verses together. Won't you lift your voices with us today, if you will? Let's all sing together.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wear the news to every land. Climb the steeps and cross the waves. On the tears, our voice commands.
That last verse one more time. You're singing so well. Lift it up unto the Lord, this last verse together this morning.
All right, sing with me if you will. Let's sing together.
Give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free. Highest hill.
Welcome each one to Temple Baptist Church this morning. We are so honored that you're here with us. There's several things going on today. Number one, it's Time Change Sunday, and I just want to thank you for being in church today. And God bless you. I realize that is one of the hardest days of the year. And for churchgoers on Sunday morning, and I know there's a call for years now to end the time change, and my call has been even prior to that, just do it on Monday. Don't do it on Sunday morning, and I know that would be hard on the workforce area, but we're so grateful that you're here this morning, and raise your hand if you saw it, got a little snow this morning, and that's, I think, for most of us, the first snow of the year. And so we're so grateful for that. The Bible says God has been reminding me this morning, this is the day the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We've got so much to be grateful for and thankful for. We live in a wonderful country, and I realize it's not perfect, but it's still my home, and I'm grateful for it. And then I've got something to be thankful for, and that's you. And I'm so grateful that you're here this morning. And it's also Friend and Family Sunday. And so I don't know if you're here. I have a lot of first-time visitors, and we're so grateful that you're here with us this morning. I know many are here for Friend and Family Sunday, and perhaps you're here for just visiting Temple Baptist Church this morning. We're so grateful that you're here as well. And we want to start the service with a word of prayer and ask the Lord for His blessings, because I don't know about you, but I need the Lord every day of my life. I need Him in every direction, every step, every situation. I need the Lord and His blessings upon my life. And we crave the Lord's blessings upon the ministry here at Temple Baptist Church. And so let's pray together that God would bless in a very special way this morning. And then we'll look forward to hearing the choir sing for us once again. Let's pray together. Father, we love You this morning. We're so grateful for the opportunity that You've given us to be here this morning. Father, thank You for the rain. Thank You for the cold, Father, in so many different ways. We are so quick to complain and gripe because it's cold and rainy. But, Father, that makes us so much appreciate the sunshine that is to come. And, Father, I pray and ask today that You would bless our hearts, encourage us and equip us and strengthen us as Your children. Father, I pray as those of us who have received Christ as our Savior at some point in our life, that you would, Father, speak to us through your word, through the songs, that you would stir us, and Father, that you would comfort us and challenge us through your word to live more fervently for you now more than ever before. And Father, if there's someone today that does not know Jesus as their Savior, they may have heard about him and know a lot about him, but never have received him. I pray that today would be the day that they would do that. And Father, we'll thank you and praise you for all that you do. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated this morning. Right before our choir sings, I do want to remind you to be in prayer for our children's ministry. Lots going on in the building across the breezeway. They're in our educational building with nursery and wiggle worms, children's church, junior church. So many things going on. A lot of volunteer staff and kids over there to this morning. And I want you to be in prayer for them as they're over there. And then also, if you're here for the very first time, we want to thank you for being here for Temple Baptist Church. If you have received a visitor packet, I would like for you to look inside there, if you would, and to find the visitor's card there. And if you would be so kind to fill that out for us with the pen provided also in the bag, and drop that in the offering plate a little bit later on in the service when it comes by. We'd love to have record of you being here with us this morning. And I just want to find out, if you are here for the very first time and have not yet received a gift visitor packet, we would love to place that in your hand. And so if you have not received one, would you hold your hand up really quickly and hold it there? We got one up here. One right here in the orange shirt. Anybody else? I'm scanning. Okay. I'm seeing some this number and this number and this number. I'm trying to discern there. Okay. All right. So we got one right here. Dad's helping us with this. And so we'll get one to you here in just a second. All right. Choir's going to sing for us. I know the Lord will use them to be a blessing to you this morning.
No one knew how alone I was feeling, and the emptiness I tried so hard to hide. And though I laughed and said my life was fine without you, I was covering up the secret tears I cried. Then one day someone told me of your mercy and the love you showed on a hill called Calvary, where you died to purchase my redemption. When you broke sin's power and set my spirit free, I'm amazed that you love me. I'm amazed how you care. Through your precious blood I found pardon, and my sins are washed. They're all washed away. Oh, my sins are washed away. It's true, there have been days that I've failed you, and Lord, you know the many times I've gone astray. But I've learned your love is stronger than my weakness, and your ear is open every time I pray. No one else has ever cared for me like you, Lord. Other friends could never be as close to me. I'm not afraid to face the problems of tomorrow, knowing you are everything I'll ever need. I'm amazed that you love me. Washed away.
Let's all stand together once again, all over the building this morning, standing, smiling, singing out with all of our hearts unto the Lord this morning.
What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the fruit that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
We're going to take a moment now. The choir's coming down. Leave your seat if you will. Let's turn around and shake hands this morning. Second and fourth verses together.
For my part on this I see nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow.
A little bit different. Ushers, if you will, you can put your plates down there, and if you'll come forward, Brother Holly, if you'll help give each one of the ushers one of these, and listen carefully, everybody can be seated except if you have brought a visitor. Now, visitors can be seated, but if you have brought a visitor, we want you to remain standing, okay? So if you're some of our home folk and brought a visitor, we want you to remain standing. Everybody else can be seated. And this is what we're going to do. We have some gift cards in here, and we've got a little mixed up. Some of these have $500, some have $1,000. And no, I'm just kidding. I wish we could do that. But this is just a small token of our appreciation for you being here this morning. This is not a bribe. This is just something that we want to, just a small gift. I think they're $5 Chick-fil-A gift cards. And I thought I'd get a hallelujah, praise the Lord on Chick-fil-A there. And we had our young adult fellowship last night. This is our group from age 19 to 49. We had a great time. We did laser tag down in close to Charlotte and mini golf. Had a great time, great group. and I can't remember when I laughed so much and just had just enjoyable time with God's people and just fun. And I went to eat lunch and all of that. And when we were, not lunch, but supper, when we were eating supper, we were eating at a barbecue place, and I was reminded something to Chick-fil-A. And I asked them at the table, I said, I want to find out who has had the cauliflower sandwich. And Jalen had, and he has convinced me it's not worth, stick with the chicken is basically the quote, okay? Stick with the chicken, okay? It's worked for so long. Just keep on with the chicken, all right? And but I love cauliflower. It's one of my favorite vegetables. I really do. And anyway, I don't want to preach a sermon on Chick-fil-A. But anyway, this is just a simple token of just a way that we can simply say thank you for coming today. And then this is what we need to do. So if you have brought someone with you, if you will, ushers are going to go forward, and if you will tell them how many you need, okay, and they're going to give you as many as you need, and count yourself in that because you get one too if you brought a visitor, okay? And so let them know to do that. All right, let's have some music, and ushers, let's do this as quickly as we can. All right, go ahead at this time. Come forward at this time. We're going to pray over our offering. Let's be faithful in our giving this morning. God has been so very gracious to us, and it's through the giving of His people on a faithful, regular basis. Let's be faithful in our giving this morning, our tithe and offering. You can also give online at templebaptistchurch.info. Securely there, a lot of folks do that. And so let's be faithful in our tithe and offering this morning. And we're going to have a song during the offertory, and I know it will be a blessing to you this morning. Steve Carlton, would you come up here and pray for us? We love Brother Steve and Miss Penny. They're a wonderful blessing to our church. And after he gets done praying for us, we'll have a song this morning.
Let us pray. Our gracious and heavenly Father, we do thank and praise you for allowing us to be here this morning. Lord, we thank you for the visitors you sent our way, Lord. We pray through the Spirit, Lord, that you touch their hearts, Lord. And we just want to just honor you in all that we do. And as we take this offering, Lord, we just ask that you bless it, bless the giver, bless the gift alike, Lord, and just use it for your honor and your glory. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
Amen. Hold. me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Those he saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by him at such a cost, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. For my life he bled and died. Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life, he will hold me fast. Till my faith is turned to sight, when he comes at last, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold.
Appreciate that this morning. Take your Bibles, please. Look with us in Luke chapter number 10. Luke chapter number 10. If you didn't bring your Bible, that's fine. I want you to just listen along. But if you did bring your Bible, turn with us so you can see where we're coming from here this morning. And Luke chapter number 10, and we'll begin reading in verse number 30. Luke chapter number 10 and verse number 30. And then we'll introduce this thought to you this morning. And then have a song, and then we'll get right into the message after that. Luke chapter 10, Luke chapter 10, and verse number 30. I realize the great reality of people falling asleep on Sunday mornings in Baptist churches, and I realize that increases greatly on Time Change Sunday, so I will be cautious. And we'll keep it under the message under an hour and a half this morning. Most of our folks are laughing because they know that's a joke, okay? For you visiting with us, that is a joke, okay? We will not be long, okay? Luke chapter 10, look with me in verse number 30. The Bible said, "And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him, and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, And when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine. And of course, they didn't have Band-Aids and type of Neosporin and that type of thing then. Pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence, and gave them to the host, and said unto him, Take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which of now these three, thinkest thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, He that showed mercy on him. And then said Jesus unto him, Go, and do thou likewise. Let's pray. We'll have a song, and then we'll get right into the message this morning. Father, we love you. Thank you for your word. And I pray that you'd use me, Father, for just a few moments to be a blessing to your people. I ask that you give me clarity of mind this morning, and you'd speak to me and speak through me and use me to be a blessing and a help and encouragement. And Father, we'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
The splendor of heaven, a crown, a robe, and a throne. But what kind of love would lead you to me, the safety of that kind of home? I know that you willingly suffer, but why would you suffer for? Was the price you'd have to pay. When they cried, Crucify, Lord, you didn't have to die, but you did it anyway. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it. Lord, sometimes I feel like a vessel, just useless old pieces of clay. But somehow you saw more, something worth dying for. You gave more than you should have paid. When you knew I was lost, and you knew that a cross was the price you'd have to pay. When they cried, Crucify, Lord, you didn't have to die, but you did it anyway. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it. Now I'll never see what you saw in me, 'cause you knew I would never be perfect. But I'm just so glad somehow you thought I was worth it. But I'm just so glad that somehow you thought I was worth it.
Amen. Thank you so much, group. I appreciate that so very much. I'm thankful that Jesus thought enough about me to come and die for my sins at Calvary nearly 2,000 years ago, and yours as well. I want to talk to you for this simple subject for just a few moments on this thought of someone cares for you. Someone cares for you. And we just read just a moment ago this story that Jesus shared with his disciples many, many years ago, as we said just a moment, about 2,000 years ago. As we just read this story in Luke chapter 10, there's a couple different people that I want to bring out of this story. And really, literally, that's what it is. Jesus would call them, they were called parables or stories or illustrations that Jesus would tell to get a point across, to get a doctrine or teaching across from Scripture or from himself, of course, the Word of God. And several different people in this story. One, we find there's a certain man here. There's a certain man, doesn't give his name. And then there's some thieves, okay, that are listed here, we just read about. And then there's a Levite, okay, he's a religious type of man. There's also a priest, which is also a religious man. And then there's a certain Samaritan. It doesn't say again what these names are because it is a parable, it is a story. There is cities listed, Jericho, Jerusalem, but it is a story. It's a parable to, again, Jesus is trying to teach us something this morning. And so I want to draw a story for us this morning based upon what Jesus told his disciples, based upon these different people. Just a background here, just a brief understanding of what we just read just a moment ago. We find this certain man, and he packs up his bags, backpack, whatever, and he leaves the city of Jerusalem, and he goes down to this town or city of Jericho. And unfortunately, on his way there, he gets mobbed. He gets robbed by this group of gangsters, if you will. You call them whatever you want to. They attack him. They take everything he has, and they leave him half dead. Now, he's laying there. If you can kind of picture this in your mind, he perhaps had a little bit of money. He's perhaps going to Jericho to do some business or whatever it may have been, be with his family. I don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us. But he's laying now on the side of the road. He is literally, as Jesus said, half dead. He's been beaten. He's wounded. He's bleeding. I can see him just basically hard breathing at this point. And he's laying on the side of the road. He's lost everything that he probably has. And he's half dead. Here comes a, not necessarily in this certain order, but here comes a Levite. A Levite comes by and he goes down the same road. It's not a big highway interstate that we would have today. They're walking paths or paths that donkeys would go down. He sees this guy. It's obvious that he's been beaten and everything is taken from him. He walks by, he sees him, and he steps on to the other side and goes on his way. Secondly, we find a priest. And the priest does the same thing. He is walking down the road. He sees this guy laying there half dead, maybe hard at breathing. There's blood all over the place. I can see his clothes ripped up from the thieves trying to get the money out, whatever. And he sees him and steps onto the other side. Doesn't do a thing. Doesn't say, I wish you well. Doesn't throw any coins there. Doesn't give him any water. Nothing but pass by on the other side. Basically to say, I don't want anything to do with you. You're a little bit too nasty for me to handle. And so they go on the other way. Then comes this certain Samaritan. This certain Samaritan is from Samaria, no doubt. And this certain Samaritan sees him. He goes up to him and he takes care of him, as we'll see this morning. He takes care of him. He puts him on his own beast or his own donkey. And he takes him to the nearby inn or the hotel. And he pays for his stay there. And he makes sure that he's perhaps got some business elsewhere. He cannot stay with this man he's helped, this crippled man. But he's paying somebody to make sure that he is taken care of in his absence. He has gone the second mile in making sure that he is taken care of. Now, by application today, this certain man from Jericho, we're going to call him the crippled man. Then we're going to group the priest and the Levite together because they're both religious people. The Levites speak of the religion of the Jewish people, the priest, of course, as well. And so both of these have occupation far as the law and the religion of that the day in the Old Testament. And they basically do basically the same thing. See the guy in need and pass by on the other side. And so we're going to kind of group them together, and we're going to call them the careless men or the careless man. And then the certain Samaritan, we're going to call him the compassionate man. So you got the crippled man, and then you got these careless men, and then you got this compassionate man. The crippled man in this story this morning is going to represent you and me. You say, Pastor, I don't want to be the crippled man. I understand that. But for the sake of the story and for the understanding of it, place yourself in the crippled man's shoes for just a few moments. And then we have the careless men. They are going to represent religion, not true Christianity, not Jesus Christ, but the works of religion, going a routine understanding of just going about the ins and outs of a church and even ministry and even trying to be kind to people, but under the name of religion, not the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the compassionate man, who is he going to represent? Christ. We have four people, all right, that Jesus Christ is who is going to be representative of this compassionate man. So I want you to notice just three quick things this morning about these different people here this morning. Number one, if you're taking notes, I want you to notice again this crippled man. Look back with me if you have your Bibles there in verse number 30. In verse number 30, once again, we find Jesus talking and telling this story, this literal story that's been recorded and preserved by his word many years now. Verse number 30, Jesus said, answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. I want you to notice two things about this crippled man. One, his path. His path. His path in verse number 30, two important words to note is the fact that he went down. He went down from Jerusalem. He's there in Jerusalem. He goes down to Jericho. Now, this man's path was geographically going downward. The elevation, okay, the physical landscape of that area there, he goes literally down. But there's an application there. And that is that the men's path was not only geographically going down in elevation, if you will, but he's going downward spiritually, if you will. And I want to help you with that just for a few minutes. He's going down. Anytime in the Bible, most time in the Bible, if not all the time, it's important to understand that when someone goes down, that's exactly what they're doing, not only physically or maybe elevation-wise as far as the landscape is concerned, but in many cases, if not all cases, they're going down spiritually, emotionally, mentally, in a lot of different areas. There's a lot of areas, would you agree, that you could go down in? Go down in your marriage, down in your finances, go down in a lot of trouble. You can go down in a lot of areas. But when a person says, he went down, a lot of times you understand it's not the best way to describe somebody. He went down. Okay? And so in the Bible, in a good example of that is Jonah. Jonah was an Old Testament preacher, prophet. And God came to Jonah one day and he said, Jonah, I want you to go preach to this city, this wicked place, massive city called Nineveh. And Jonah says, It's in the Hebrew text. He said, no, I'm just kidding. But basically, that's what Jonah said. He said, no. He said, Lord, I'm not going to do that. And so he ran from the Lord. He tried to get away from the Lord. And we understand you're not going to get away from the Lord. You're not going to get away from the creator of the heaven and the earth. And so Jonah tries to get away from the Lord. So he goes down. He goes down. And this, in our story in Luke chapter 10 this morning, this man went down not only geographically, but spiritually. This path that he was on from Jerusalem to Jericho, it led him to destruction. It led him to destruction because he's on this downward path, spiritually, figuratively, by way of application. He has lost everything he has had, even half, if you will, of his life. He has lost everything. He fell among thieves. The thieves are not going to just take one or two things. They're going to take everything. They're going to take advantage of this certain man, this crippled man, and they have crippled him, no doubt, to make sure that he could not tell anybody else in a timely manner what has happened to him and make sure that he cannot follow them and even try to attempt to hurt them in any way. And so they've wounded him and left him there half dead. This natural, this path that he's going is a spiritually downward path. And can I bring this home to you and me for just a minute? This path that he's going down is a path to destruction. And our path that we take, our natural path, is a path of destruction. And I'm going to give you a verse to help you understand that. It's not a negative message. You'll see that in a moment. But the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians 1, 7 through 9, "And to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power." Can I be honest with you? God's word is full of hope. It's full of love. It's full of peace. But it's also, if you'll read it and you'll use common sense and discernment and intelligence, you'll understand that the word of God also gives very clear definitions of judgment to come. God says, "I love you." God says, "I care for you." And by the way, nothing says it more than the cross of Calvary. And what has been sung about this morning. And then, well, God's word is full of that. But God's word, we would be very ignorant to just blaze by the comments and the word of God when it speaks of judgment to come. Because God says there's a path of destruction. And that is a path for people that are in their natural state without God. You see, the Bible teaches us, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And God told me that, and I must confess, I am a sinner. I understand it. Nobody had to teach me that. I know it. If somebody says, "Josh Boles, you're a sinner," I'll say, "Yes, I am. I try my best." We live in a day and time when people want to debate that. "Well, you're a sinner." "No, I'm not." "Are you perfect?" "Yeah, pretty close." Unfortunately, we live in that type of society. But God says, "I want you to be honest. You do make mistakes." You don't have to rob a bank to be labeled a sinner. You understand that God is holy. He is perfect. He is righteous. In other words, he's right in every way. And God says, "You're not." And God says, "You're not up to my standard." And when we say we're perfect, we're putting ourselves up to God's standard. And friend, that doesn't work. And we'll never get to heaven putting ourselves on God's level. God says you have to understand that you are a sinner, and yes, you may do a lot of good things, but yet you're not perfect, and you need to be saved from that disease called sin. That natural path that you're born on, a path of sin, is going to one day lead to a path of destruction, of eternity without God in a place called hell. And God said, "That's why I loved you. That's why I died for you, so you can have your sins forgiven." We'll get to that in just a moment. But in our natural state, without God, we're on a path that leads to destruction. This man was a downward path, not only geographically, but spiritually. His path downward led to destruction, physically, financially, so many other things. And the path that we're on without God leads to a path of destruction. It also leads to a path of death. This man was half dead. And again, our natural path leads to death. The Bible says, Romans 6:23, "For the wages," in other words, the payment or the price of sin, "is death." And that's why people have to die. Yes, it's because of cancer and heart attack and car wreck and so many different things. The list is endless, really, almost. But we all have to die. But the reason that we all have to die is because of our sin nature, that path of sin that we're headed down, a life without God. So this crippled man, he's on a path, and it's downward. And then I want you to notice not only his downward path led to destruction, just like ours does. Our natural path without God leads to destruction, leads to death. But I want you to notice also this crippled man's predicament. If you still have your Bible, look in verse 30. "And wounded him and departed, leaving him." These thieves did the natural thing that thieves would do. They took everything and they left. They're not going to wait around for the police. They're not going to wait around for his buddies to get a mob up to go attack them. They're gone, leaving him. And that's exactly what we are in our natural state. We're just crippled. We're on our path without God. We're going on this path of destruction and heartache and really in many areas without God. And we're in a predicament because in reality, people can give you counsel. People can help you, encourage you. But without the Lord, just let me be honest with you, where you're going to find yourself in a predicament as this man did as well. Now, notice the second thing. And that is these careless men. We're going to group them two together, and we're going to call them the careless man. Back in verse number 31 and verse number 32. In verse number 31, we find the priest. He sees this crippled man. He's gone on this downward path, not only physically, geographically, but spiritually. He's lost everything he's had. These men go by him. The priest in verse number 31 go by him, and they realize his condition and could care less. They could care less. They go by. Notice again in verse number 31, the priest saw him. It was like obvious. He saw him. He knew what kind of condition he was in, and he didn't do not one thing to help him. The Levite, it is very interesting, the Levite, which also represents religion in Jesus' story, did the very same thing. Maybe they had this thought in their mind. I don't want to get dirty. He's too dirty for me. Maybe they had this in mind. There's nothing really he could probably do for me in return. He's lost everything he's got. If I help him, I want some payback for it. If I do something for him, I want him to help me down. And maybe they had this thought. He's half dead. I mean, he's struggling breathing. I don't know the situation. I kind of visualize it in my mind. This dirt road. Man's laying there. He's bruised. He's bleeding all over the place. He's half dead. He may be even unconscious. And they're thinking to themselves, he's already gone. Nothing I can do about it. And can I say that's what religion works without Christ will do? Religion says work. Religion says do this and do that. And religion says do it so very often and do it so very much. It says bow down to a statue every so often. It says read this book every so often. It says pray this prayer every so often. Religion is what it is. It's religion. It is under the guise of doing works in order to get ahead spiritually. But religion gets you nowhere spiritually. Only through the Lord Jesus Christ is found eternal life. The Bible teaches us very clearly that we are not saved. In other words, we're not forgiven for our sin because of our works of righteousness. But by the death and the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, who died in my place and who died for your place. Can you picture yourself up on the cross? And because you had to pay for your sins, God says so. Not me, not our church. The Bible teaches. God says you have the wages of sin is death. You've got to be punished for your sin. You admit you're a sinner and you got to be punished for your sin. And Jesus said, no, I'm taking his place. And Jesus took your place on the cross. He took your sin upon yourself. And now all we have to do to have eternal life is to say, Lord, I believe that you took my place. I understand I'm a sinner and I want you to come into my heart and save me. Take me to heaven when I die. And I'm so grateful for that. But these careless men, they looked on his condition. They looked on his chances, perhaps, and said, it's not worth it. And that is what religion will do, in a sense. So it'll help you, but when religion and religious leaders, even, if you will, understand that you're too far gone, they don't want to touch it. If they realize there's nothing they can benefit from your life of destruction, they don't want to touch it. But Jesus died for sinners. That brings us to our third and last thought, and that is the compassionate man. Now, this is my favorite part. And look in verse number 33. So the crippled man, let's review for just a minute. The crippled man represents me and you. He's on this downward path spiritually. It led him to amongst these thieves, so it caused destruction in his life. It caused near death in his life. And that's exactly where we need to put ourselves in his shoes, understanding that a life without God is a downward life. It is a life that will end in destruction. It is life that will end with death without God. And religion, as much as many books as you can want to listen to, as many YouTubers as you want to watch or listen to, in reality, I think you'll understand, maybe even at the end of some people's life, they'll look back and say, it was all vanity. There was nothing the amount to nothing. It was just words and good things. But substance is found in Jesus. But this compassionate man, look at it, verse number 33, a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him. Now, the crippled man represents you and me. The careless man represents religion and good works and so forth. The compassionate man represents who? Okay, the answer is Jesus. Let's try that one more time. I'm keeping in mind it is time change Sunday. Okay, here we go. Ready? The answer is Jesus. Here we go. Everybody on the count of three. One, two, three. Jesus. There we go. That was much better. The compassionate man represents Jesus. And I want you to notice two things about him. One, this compassionate man came to where he was. He came to where he was. The Levite are going down this main road that led down to Jerusalem, down to Jericho. They see this man crippled, half dead, wounded, taking everything he had. They go on the other side. The Levite, the priest, both of them. The Samaritan, this certain Samaritan comes by. He sees him half dead, left with nothing, and he goes to him. And that is exactly what Jesus has done for you. Come here for a minute. You see, I have nothing to offer the one who has everything. Nothing. So I'm going to give my car to God. Friend, he don't need that. Now, if you want to dedicate it to the ministry, now this is not a, we're not talking about finances here. I'm just simply saying, I think a lot of times we think we can buy our way somewhere. You can't do that with God because he don't need it. He has everything. He is the creator of heaven and earth. When you read your Bible, you've got to come to that conclusion. He don't need my substance. He's the one who gave it to me. He's the one who gave me life. He don't need my money. He don't need anything. And yet he loved you so much that he left everything in heaven. When you read the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, that talks about the end to come, you'll also find that it gives us a glimpse of what's going on in heaven and what's going to go on in heaven for all eternity. Can I give you a glimpse of that? Can I give you a glimpse of that? Okay, thank you. All right, I was going to do it anyway, but there's these beasts that you and I have never seen. And by the way, you say, well, I saw a movie and I think that I do not think that a movie can depict the glories that you're going to see in heaven. I just really don't believe that. And there's some crazy stuff out there. There's pretty cool stuff out there. I understand that. But I just don't think they can tell. I just don't think so. But there's beasts. There's these angelic beings, these seraphims. There's all kinds of created beings that you and I have never seen, and they're bowing down before God in His throne night and day, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. He doesn't need us, yet He loved you so very much. I'm reminded that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, the Good Samaritan came to this little crippled man. He had nothing to offer. This crippled man had nothing. The thieves took everything. He didn't even have the strength to get up. But yet the Samaritan came to where he was. The Samaritan had compassion to him. The Samaritan had something in his heart to care for somebody who couldn't care for him in return. And I'm so thankful that that's exactly what Jesus did for me. When I could not love you, the Bible teaches us in the book of 1 John, we love Him because He first loved us. And the only reason that we can say, that we can say that I love Jesus with all my heart is because He has proven it, that He loved you by dying for you, by saying, for God so loved the world who we are in, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. You see, God has proved it in His Word. He's proved it in His works. He's proved it at Calvary that He loved you and that He wants you to be saved so that you can go to heaven. When I could offer Him nothing of value in return. Now, as His child, once I trust Him as my personal Savior, He wants me to live for Him and honor Him with my words and with my mind and with my actions, but still yet I have nothing to offer Him as a sinner, and yet He loved me, cared for me, gave His life for me. And this is the second thing. The compassionate man not only came to where he was, as Jesus came to where we were, to earth from heaven. The compassionate man cared for his needs. The compassionate man cared for his needs. Look with me in verse number 34. I'm almost done. Verse number 34, and I was getting ready to say you could go use that Chick-fil-A card on a iced coffee. That's one of the greatest things they have. Not an iced coffee, a frosted coffee. And to wake you up a little bit for tonight's service, but you know, they're closed on Sunday. I'm just reminded of that. I'm sorry, you'll have to use that tomorrow. The compassionate man came to where he was, and the compassionate man cared for his needs. I'm thankful God cares for my needs. Look at it, verse 34. The first thing he did was he bound up his wounds. I'm thankful that, listen, everybody in this room, I guarantee you've got some wounds. You've got some open wounds right now. You've got somebody that's hurt you. You've got somebody that's betrayed you. You've got somebody that's disappointed you. Listen, if I would have tell you nobody's disappointed me, I would lie to you, because I've had people that disappointed me, lied to me, broken my heart. You have wounds. The whole world, let's just be honest, have open wounds. That's why people walk around, I'm afraid, like zombies. They're brokenhearted. They've been disappointed by mom and dad, by their son or daughter. They've been brokenhearted by their employer. They've been brokenhearted by their neighbor, their wife, or their spouse, or whatever it may be. And the world is full of open wounds. But I'm thankful that I know a Jesus, a Savior who can bind up those wounds. And the Bible teaches us in Isaiah chapter 61, in verse number 1, it's actually prophecy concerning Jesus Christ. And if you'll study your Bible, you'll learn that Jesus actually quoted this during his earthly ministry. And in Isaiah 61:1, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. You see, Jesus and this Good Samaritan, as he goes up, he came to where this crippled man was, as Jesus came to you and me. This Good Samaritan, this certain Samaritan, bound up his wounds. And Jesus can do that same thing for you. See, I don't believe that. Why don't you just jump in and say, Jesus, I'm going to trust you for this situation in my life. Because, listen, you can sit down in my office, and I could sit across from you, across from my desk, and you could open up those wounds in your life, in your mind, in your heart. And you can say, Pastor, this has happened, and this is going on. And your tears could run down your cheeks, and I could have tears running down my cheeks, because I love you and I have compassion towards you. But you, at the end of the day, there's going to be 9 times out of 10, I'm not going to be able, now I can counsel you according to the Word of God, but 9 times out of 10, I've not walked where you've walked. I don't live at your address. I don't know your situation, but I know someone who has. And I can point you to him. And I can testify this morning that I have had wounds. I have had chances to get bitter. I have had chances to get bent out of shape. I've had chances that have hurt me, and people that have disappointed me. And I would go to my wife, and my wife would say, well, Joshua, I love you, but I can't help you. And I thank God for a godly wife that says, go pray about it. And I would find myself somewhere all by myself and saying, Lord, I need you, because I've been hurt and I've been wounded, and I don't know anybody else that can help me. And God never fails to give me the peace and the strength and the grace that I needed. And he will bind up those wounds. You say, I don't get that. Have you been there? Have you gone? I know you've been at the wounded wound section, but have you been in the prayer closet? And have you given that need to the Lord? God is in a way of binding up wounds. Notice the next thing he did in verse 34. He poured in oil and wine. I'm thankful that Jesus, as the Good Samaritan, takes care of my needs. Not only does he bind up my wounds as I seek him in prayer and Bible reading, but also God pours in things that I need. I don't know about you. I don't need oil and wine, but I certainly, by application, I need some love in my heart. I need some joy in my life. I need the peace of God that passeth all understanding. And through his word, God will pour that into your life, figuratively, by way of application. Now, I'm afraid that we're so busy, just wrapped in our lives on YouTube, listening to everybody. And I'm not against YouTube. I watch some funny videos myself. It's good to laugh. I watch some stuff on things like that. But in reality, you can get so filled up with all of this social media and everybody's perspective on this, everybody's point of view on this, that we just kind of get the Bible out of our lives. This is where you're going to get poured in love and joy and peace in your life. Get back to the Bible. I won't ask you to do this, but in your mind, in your heart, I want you to take inventory right now. How much do you spend on your phone in comparison to the Word of God? If we're spending more time on social media than we are in the Word of God, it's no wonder that we are in a mess that we are in as a society. There's no wonder, even as God's people. And you say, well, Pastor, I'm addicted to that. I understand. That's where it goes. But may God help us. That's message number 14 within the first message this morning. Look at the next thing Jesus did. He cared for his wounds. He bound up his wounds. He poured in all the wine. He brought him to a place of rest. Verse number 34, and set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn. Can I say that God, as the Good Samaritan, will bring you to a place of rest? Not necessarily physically, but emotionally and mentally and spiritually in your life. Listen, I need rest. And listen, can I just be honest with you? I don't have the finances to go to, some of the guys were talking about Jamaica last night, going to Jamaica. Hey, listen, next time you go, hey, listen, take me with you. I'll go, you know. But listen. I'm going to bring the application here. I can't get, and I understand, everybody needs that rest. We got vacations planned this year. Listen, I think that's wonderful. You need that. It's scriptural. Jesus told his apostles, disciples, he said, come apart and rest a while. Listen, but if I find my rest emotionally and spiritually only in going outside my home, I'm going to be broke unless you give me a couple million. I mean, you know, I'm joking, of course. But listen, I've got to find my rest in Jesus Christ. That's what's going to keep me going. It is not my motorcycle, although I love that. It helps me as a vent. But that is not where I must find my rest. Because there's going to be days like today when that thing is going to stay in the garage. And if I get sideways, if I get going crazy, I'm not going to get that thing out. I've got to find my rest in Christ. Notice the next thing he did. He paid his cost in verse number 35. And on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host. You see, this good Samaritan paid the cost. And that's exactly what Jesus has done for you and me. He paid our cost. And then verse 35, I'm done. He, musicians, you come. Instrumentalists, you come. Verse number 35. Don't close your Bible. Look at it with me in verse 35. And on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host, and said unto them, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. He promised to return, and that's exactly what Jesus has done. He's promised to come back for you and me. Now, I close with this, but don't close your Bibles. Everybody look this way for just a moment. I close with this. And if you don't hear anything else I say, I want you to get this. May we realize what Jesus has done for that Samaritan in Luke chapter 10, what he did for that crippled man is the same thing that Jesus has done for you and me. May we never forget that. And I want you to look with me in verse 37. Jesus is using this story to talk to a man in response to a man. And this is what he says at the end of the story. And if you and I have received Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, look at verse 37 at the end of it. Go and do thou likewise. As a child of God, as a saved individual, you know what I'm to do with that story? I'm to look at that and say, I am to be a Christian, Christ-like. I am to imitate the life of Christ. And it is obvious that we see Christ in this certain Samaritan. And so I am to do that same thing for other people. I am to go where they are. I am to care for their needs. And I cannot maybe give you Josh Boles and a lot of the wisdom. I can't give you a lot of wisdom from Josh Boles. I cannot pour out a whole lot of Josh Boles because I don't, let's be honest, I don't have a lot to give you. But I can point you to someone who can bind up your wounds. I can point you to someone who can pour in love and peace and joy that you so desperately need, and I need as well. And I can point you to someone that will pay, that has paid your costs and that will help you in your life. And then lastly, if you know what Jesus has done for you, but have never trusted Him as your personal Savior, I would like for you to do that today. Because this is obvious. Anybody would say that. Well, that we see Jesus in that Samaritan. A matter of fact, if you look at verse 33, the Samaritan has a capital S. I think that's interesting. I think it's referring to Jesus, no doubt about that. And the fact of the matter is, Jesus has done for you. He's paid your cost. He's done so much. And eternal life is available if you'll trust Jesus as your Savior. I would love to talk to you one-on-one. A lady will take the Bible one-on-one, show you how you can know for sure you're going to heaven. But I would love for you to trust Christ as your personal Savior so you can know for sure you're going to heaven. You can have that peace of knowing of eternal life and have that hope in your life. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Musicians, I want you to softly play. And I want to ask you this question this morning. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, I know for sure I'm saved. I don't know just only about Jesus, but I know I've accepted Him as my Savior. I know I'm going to heaven. I can remember the time when I've accepted Jesus. Would you raise your hand and hold it there for just a moment? Thank you. I appreciate that sincerity. I wonder if you're here, you could put your hands down. I wonder if you're here this morning and you say, Pastor, I must be honest. I've never trusted Christ. Oh, I know all about Him. Pastor, I'll be honest, I'm trying to do a lot of good things. I'm trying to work, read books, work hard. But I realize I need to accept Jesus as my personal Savior. I wonder if you're here this morning and you say, I would like to do that. Or perhaps, Pastor, I'd just like for you to pray for me. I would love to pray for you in my own private time. I'm not going to pray for you out loud. I'm not going to call your name. We're not going to come to you right now. But I would love to pray for you. Would you slip up your hand right now and say, Pastor, would you pray for me? I see that hand. Anybody else? Would you pray for me? I know all about Jesus, but I've never trusted Him. Anybody else? Would you raise it up and right back down? It's between God and you and me. I'm just trying to help you, to point you to Him. Here in just a second, we're going to stand. And when we stand, dear sir, if you raise your hand about not being saved, I want you to come forward and let us take the Bible, show you how you can know for sure you're going to heaven. Dear lady, if you raised your hand a moment ago, why don't you come forward and let us take the Bible, show you how you can know for sure you're going to heaven. Would you do that, please? Would you let us do that? We would love to see you trust Christ, put your faith in Him. And then perhaps if you're here this morning, you are a child of God, you are saved. When's the last time you thanked Him for what He's done for you? I wonder if you'd find your place around this altar to say, Lord, thank you for what you've done for me. Well, the Holly's going to sing. Let's all stand. Would you come right now? Salvation, whatever it may be.
Come, every soul by sin oppressed. There's mercy with
the Lord. Right now, would you step out? Come forward. We'll talk to
you. And He will surely give you rest by trusting in Word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now.
Just one more verse.
Jesus shed His precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow.
Sing it.
Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. He will save you, He will save you, He will save you now.
Let's pray together. Father, we love You this morning. Thank You for Your Word. I pray to get that today, if there's someone they have a need spiritually that they would not leave this campus without talking to someone, perhaps myself, my wife, or someone about that need, whether salvation, whether that's getting things right in their heart, whatever that may be. Father, I pray that you'd help us with that. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. We're going to have our video announcements, and then we'll be dismissed. They'll last just about 2 minutes or so. And I do want to say this, that if you are here and you have a need, my wife and I are usually the last people to leave, and we'll help you in any way that we can, all right? Let's have these video announcements, and then we'll be dismissed this morning.
Thank you for joining us here today at Temple Baptist Church. We would like to remind you of a few upcoming events.
This Tuesday, March 14th, the widowed ladies of our church will be meeting at the Southern Family Restaurant in Poptown at 11:30 a.m. for a time of fellowship. If you would like to be a part of this luncheon, please see the sign-up sheet today located in the entryway.
Our annual Easter Spectacular is coming up on Saturday, April 8th. We are very excited about this fun and exciting event for the kids of our church and community. Make plans to join us between 11 a.m. and 2 p.m. here on our church campus for a large Easter egg hunt, inflatables, face painting, free food, and concessions. If you would like to be a part of helping in this event, we are now taking candy donations in the bin located near the media desk.
We are really looking forward to our upcoming spring revival that will begin on Sunday, March 26th and go through Wednesday, March 29th. We are very excited to have Dr. Scott Caudill preaching for us for this upcoming meeting just 2 weeks away. Let's begin making plans to attend each service and praying now that God will do great things during this week.
The month of March has been set aside as Pastor's Wife Appreciation Month. Next Sunday, after our evening service, we will have a celebration in Heritage Hall for our pastor's wife, Ms. Hannah Boles. Make plans to join us for this special time as we show our appreciation to this special lady.
Our next teen activity will be here at the church this Saturday, March 18th, for a life-size game night. We are looking forward to this fun event with our teens. For any questions, please see Brother or Mrs. Holland.
The Ladies Missionary Prayer Fellowship Ministry of our church will have a cooking night in the Activity Center this Tuesday, March 14th at 7 p.m. This will be a great time of fellowship and ministry for the ladies of our church. Make plans now to be a part of this great event.
Once again, thank you for joining us today. We would like to invite each family to join us once again this evening at 6 p.m. for special singing and a helpful message from God's Word.
All right, let's all stand together. I want to mention to you this morning, don't forget about service tonight, 6 o'clock. I'm really looking forward to a wonderful service. I'm going to talk to you out of the Gospel of Mark tonight about some things to put behind you. And I want you to be here in your place, if you will, 6 o'clock. Don't forget about choir practice. And then also our new members class at 5 o'clock there in the Activity Center. This is our second week of that. We had a great first week last week. And looking forward to tonight, again, 5 o'clock for those that can be here for that, okay? Brother Holly, will you stand right there where Brother Jerry is? And Brother Holly is going to be over here. If you didn't get a visitor card in the offering plate, if you'll give it to Brother Holly, he's our youth pastor, music director, of course, and he'll take care of that. And so I know some people will have those after the service. They forgot to put it in the offering plate. And if you'd like to give that to Brother Holly, we'd greatly appreciate that. Visitors, thank you so much for being here. God bless you for coming. Some of you, the steps might have been slick this morning, and you still came, and you came in the cold, the rain, and without an hour's sleep. God bless you. And please come back. We'd love to have you and be a part of Temple Baptist Church and any and all of our services. All right? Turn around, shake a hand or two, greet one another. God bless you. You're dismissed.